This is the third session explaining the book Al-Wasa'il Mufida Lil-Hayat Al-Sa'ida, The Beneficial Means to a Happy Life by Shaykh Abdul Rahman ibn Sa'di rahimahullah ta'ala. And he was talking about the reasons or the means to a happy life, and the first one he mentioned, where he elaborates quite a bit, is basically and he considers this to be the biggest and most powerful mean to a happy life. And it is basically al-Iman wal-Amal al-Salih. It is faith, belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and righteous deeds, al-Amal al-Salih. As he elaborates on this, he explains how a person who has belief in Allah and his righteous deeds, how they deal with pleasant events and blessings in life, and how such a person deals with hardships. He also, by way of comparison, mentions how a person who lacks faith in Allah and lacks the righteous deeds that are based on belief and iman, how such a person deals with the ups and downs of life. So we will carry on with this first means, with his explanation on it, or the elaboration he has on it. Then inshallah we'll move on to the second one. The last thing we said, he basically says the person who has belief in Allah and he does righteous deeds, he receives the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with thankfulness and with appreciation, and we said that means the person really enjoys them. The person really enjoys these, and he is present. He is present with these gifts. So he experiences them fully. And this is something sometimes I believe we lack. We think life is meant for suffering. Suffering is inevitable. There will be some suffering, there will be some hardship, but we should not be searching for it. It is inevitable to happen, but we are not meant to search for it. And we humans are not designed to search for misery and to search for hardship. This is why the Messenger ﷺ, before one battle, when the enemy was approaching and the Prophet ﷺ was with his companions, he said to him, he instructed them, because some of them were excited, they wanted to get into the fight. The Messenger ﷺ said, لَا تَتَمَنَّوْا لِقَاءَ الْعَدُوِ لا تتمنوا لقاء العدو ولكن إذا لقيتموهم فاصبروا. He said, don't wish for meeting your enemy. Don't look forward to that. But if you happen to meet him, or meet them in the battlefield, if you happen to engage in a combat or a fight against the enemy, then now show your patience. Now tap into your patience. So we Muslims are not supposed to seek hardship. We're not supposed to seek misery. We're not supposed to seek pain. It might come, it's actually inevitable, it will come. But we are not supposed to seek it. So when it comes by its own self, that's fine. But when we seek it, that's not an act of nearness to Allah. That's not a good act. That's not even a good attitude. So some Muslims are under the false impression that if I live a miserable life, then I'm in good shape. That's not what Allah wants from us. So he's saying that a believer, when a blessing comes to them, first of all, they live in it, they open up to it, they embrace it, they appreciate it, they let themselves live it, experience it, enjoy it. As the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the authentic hadith, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يَرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَى عَبْدِهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يَرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَى عَبْدِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to see the impact and the consequences of His blessing on His servant. So when Allah gives you something, a blessing, Allah wants to see that you enjoy it, that you make good use of it. You're actually benefiting from it, that it is giving you pleasure, that is giving you ease, that is giving you happiness. Allah loves this. Some people think Allah doesn't want us to be happy. That's a false impression. That's a false impression. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ أَنْ يَرَى أَثَرَ نِعْمَتِهِ عَلَى عَبْدِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to see the positive impact of His blessings on His servant. Allah loves to see that. And this is why the Prophet ﷺ warned one day the companions about, and this is a very good example, he warned the companions against, you know, being proud, specifically about how we, you know, dress up. So one of the companions said, O Messenger of Allah, إن رجلا يحب أن يكون ملبسه طيبا حسنا وهيئته حسنا. A person loves to be in a like in a nice, beautiful state in terms of, you know, the way he dresses up, the way he wears his clothes. He likes to look tidy, he likes to look sharp, smart. The Prophet ﷺ answered, because the person thought, okay, maybe this is part of kibr, this is part of, you know, pride and arrogance that I'm trying to show off some, you know, nice clothes and beautiful style. The Prophet ﷺ responded to his concern or his question, his inquiry, is that like a person loves to really look smart, to dress up in good clothes and look good. Is that part of it? Does it fall under it? The Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ. Allah is beautiful and Allah loves beauty. That means, yes, do that. These are aspects of our religion that have not, unfortunately, we have overlooked for such a long time. And we don't seem to appreciate them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَمِيلٌ يُحِبُّ الْجَمَالِ. Allah created so much beauty in this universe. Why? Because Allah loves beauty. And this beauty has an impact on you. It has an impact on you. So these are part, this is part of our religion. So the believer, the one who has faith, iman, and does righteous deeds, when they receive blessings, they enjoy them, they open up to them, they embrace them. There's nothing wrong with that. Some, you know, there are some people, and this is very common in the Arab world, I'm not sure of other cultures, but like when people have a good laugh, they say, oh, something bad is gonna happen. Something bad must happen. We've laughed so much that something bad must fall upon us. Like, they think Allah doesn't even want them to laugh. So if they laugh, He will destroy it for them. Like, He will take it back on them. It's not like this. So, a believer, that's a gift. A blessing is a gift from Allah. How do you receive a gift from someone that you love? You actually feel it. You appreciate it. You embrace it. You open up to it. You are present with it. You try to enjoy it and benefit from it. So that's exactly how we should deal with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's different from exploiting these blessings for something bad or going to excess in using them. Like, for example, someone, Allah gives them their wealth, they squander their money on trivial things that have no value. They waste that money. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a rational, average, reasonable kind of, you know, use of any blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us. Then he says, after appreciating this and embracing it, the person is thankful. How, and you can't reach thankfulness truly unless you enjoy the blessing. Unless you enjoy the blessing. So thankfulness is the second step that comes after enjoying the blessing. So if you miss out on the first one, which seems to be a very common case, your thankfulness will not be genuine, or at least it will not come from the heart. So second is thankfulness. Third, he says, the person will also use it in a good cause, to do something good, to help other people, to advance someone else, to bring about a smile on someone on someone's face, or to maybe open a path for someone, help someone physically, someone who's in need, maybe financially, physically, emotionally, socially. So whatever you have, whatever blessings Allah has given you, you use them in order to help out other people. So basically you're asking, how may I serve? You look around, how can I use these blessings from Allah to help other people? Allah help me, I want to help other people. Or you use it, how can I help, you know, the truth? How can I spread guidance? How can I open people's minds and hearts and eyes to the beauty that we find in the revelation that came from the Creator? And he says, so the person, when a person uses these blessings in such a good cause, there will be more happiness will come to their heart. They will experience more happiness, they will experience more emotion, more elation. Even that's greater than the first happiness they got from these blessings themselves. But if the person goes through some hardship, who's a believer, he goes through some hardship, he says, then this person realizes this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he realizes it's a test. Second, he's patient in the face of these. And he realizes that if he is patient and if he accepts the qadr of Allah favorably, then he will be rewarded immensely. He will be rewarded immensely by Allah. So he sees this as a great opportunity to grow. And we said, you know, with hardship, there's always an opportunity for growth. And this is why sometimes they say adversity is a university. Any adversity brings an opportunity for growth, an opportunity for learning. And if you reflect on your life, any kind of leap that you made forward in your life, any kind of growth, if you look, you really consider that, investigate it, you will see that before it, there was some moment of hardship and difficulty. Usually it's preceded by hardship and difficulty. So, and that's the nature of life. Before construction, there has to be demolition. Before you really, you know, rise up, you have to take a little dip. You have to take a little dip so that you develop enough momentum, then you shoot up and you move on to a higher level up. That's the nature of life. That's the nature of life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes sends us hardship and difficulty and tragedy and tests, not to make things hard for us, but for among so many other wisdoms, in order to challenge us, so a lot of the latent, hidden gifts that Allah has placed within us get activated, because otherwise they will not be challenged. So they will remain latent and dormant within us. So the believer, this is how he treats blessings, and this is how he treats hardships and calamities and misfortunes. So he's winning on both sides. This is why happiness is always his share, is always the outcome, regardless of what situation he is in. So he's saying now, فَالْمُؤْمِنُ إِذَا ابْتُلِيَ بِمَرَضٍ أَوْ فَقْرٍ أَوْ نَحْوِهِ مِنَ الْأَعْرَاضِ الَّتِي كُلُّ أَحَدٍ عُرْضَةٌ لَهَا فَإِنَّهُ بِإِيمَانِهِ وَبِمَا عِنْدَهُ مِنَ الْقَنَاعَةِ وَالرِّضَى بِمَا قَسَمَ اللَّهُ لَهُ تَجِدُهُ قَرِيرَ الْعَيْنِ لَا يَتَطَلَّبُ بِقَلْبِهِ أَمْرًا لَمْ يُقَدَّرْ لَهُ يَنْظُرُ إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ دُونَهُ وَلَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ فَوْقَهُ. He says the believer, when he is tested by an illness, disease, or poverty and lack, or any other adverse condition that everyone is prone to, everyone is subject to, he says, that person, based on his iman or her iman, and because of the kind of contentment and the richness that they have because of their connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they're content with whatever Allah provides for them, you find this person enjoying the peace of in the heart, this kind of peace and tranquility and balance, and he does not wish that he got something better. He does not wish that he got something better than what he has at the moment, because he is content with what Allah decreed for him. He looks, or she looks, at those that are below them, those that are below them, those that are less fortunate, those that are going through or experiencing more hardship, more difficulty, more challenges, less fortunate conditions. So this is why the Prophet ﷺ says, انظروا إلى من هو أسفل منكم. You know, in matters of the dunya, you look at the people who are below you, who have less than what you have been given by Allah. فَإِنَّهُ أَجْدَرُ أَلَّا تَزْدَرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ. Because this will more likely protect you from looking down upon what Allah has bestowed upon you. You know, when you look at someone who's got millions, Allah has given you thousands. You keep looking at someone to whom Allah has given millions, you know, you'll see thousands as nothing. Because that's, by way of comparison, it's little compared to the millions. So you will not appreciate Allah's gifts upon you. So the Shaykh here is saying that this believer, by means of his faith and contentment with whatever Allah has destined for him, he does not chase what Allah has not written for him. He does not chase it. He does not aspire it. He does not wish for it. He does not wish that circumstances were otherwise. And he looks at the people who are less fortunate than he is, who got less than what he has gods, and he does not look at people who have got more. Then he says, وَرُبَّمَا زَادَتْ بَهْجَتُهُ وَسُرُورُهُ وَرَاحَتُهُ عَلَى مَنْ هُوَ مُتَحَصِّلٌ عَلَى جَمِيعِ الْمَطَالِبِ الدُّنْيَوِيَّ إِذَا لَمْ يُؤْتَ الْقَنَاعَةِ. He says, and maybe, perhaps, this believer, by means of this contentment and this tranquility and satisfaction with what, and fulfillment with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him, maybe he has more happiness and more peace and more elation than people who possess everything in this world, but who lack this sense of contentment. They're not content with what Allah has given them. And that's the nature of the self. The Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لو كان لابن آدم واد من ذهب لتمنى غيره. If a man had a valley full of gold, he would wish for a second one. And if he had a second one, he would wish for a third one. That's how humans are. Humans, this is the self, the natural self. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّهُ لِحُبِّ الْخَيْرِ لَشَدِيدٍ. Allah describes man that he loves money and wealth so much in excess. We are excessive, and that's the nature of an nafs. It's always looking forward to more. It always wants more. So it wishes for this thing. Once it gets it, it wants more. It wants, what's next now? What's next? What can I get more? It's never satisfied. So there are people who possess everything you can think of about this world, still they want more. They're not satisfied. So the believer, even though he might have little, he actually experiences more happiness and more contentment and more tranquility and more peace of mind than the people who possess much more than he has. Why? Because of al-qana'ah, contentment. And this is why the Arabs say al-qana'atu kanzun la yafna. Contentment is a never-ending and inexhaustible treasure. And this echoes what the Messenger ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, Al-ghina, ghina al-nafs. He says, Laysa al-ghina min al-arad. He says, Al-ghina, you know, richness, being rich and being wealthy, doesn't come from possessions. A sense of richness doesn't come from possessions. You can never get that from possessions. Even people, there are people who possess millions and billions, still they fear a sense of lack. They live a life of lack. So, ليس الغنى عن كثرة العرض. Richness, wealth, is not from having so many possessions. ولكن الغنى غنى النفس. The real richness is that sense of contentment within. If you embrace it, you have nothing. The other day I was reading something about one person who's a very active person in human development, and he's a very rich man, very rich man. And he says, I went to this island, and I think it was Fiji, somewhere, one of these Fiji islands. And he says, so he has one of those, he bought one of those islands for himself. So that's where he lives. He says, one of the adjacent islands, I have neighbors there, so sometimes I go visit them. He says, I decided one day to go to this very poor family that I saw, that they don't have anything of the possessions that you can think about. And I know that these people have never seen a chocolate bar in their life. So I go to the man, to the father in the house, and I give him a chocolate bar as a gift. I say, that's a gift from me. He looks at it, and like his eyes are full with happiness. So now, this guy says, I thought he was gonna, you know, open it and eat it. But he didn't do that. He called all the children, or all the neighbors, the children around, his own children and the children in the neighborhood, everyone that he could get, and he started cutting it into pieces in order to give each one a piece, and he didn't get anything. Then he gave each one of them a piece, and he was looking at them and enjoying the scene without getting any piece of chocolate. He never had chocolate in his life. And he saw them enjoying it. So our friend says, I saw a level of happiness in his life I never experienced. I saw a level of happiness in his eyes I never experienced in my life, in my whole life, with all the wealth and possessions that I have. This is a person who can barely live. He barely gets what he could survive with. That's it. So I asked him, why didn't you get anything? He says, I don't need that. I just need to see the happiness in the eyes of the children. That's what fills my heart. That's a sense of richness. And when someone is really content, you can't manipulate them. You can't tempt them. You know why people fall for fraud and people fall for tricks? Usually because of their greed. Once you're greedy, once you, you know, look forward to something, you become more vulnerable because you want it now. So your attention is focused there. You stop seeing what's the tricks that are being played around. So the real richness and wealth comes from contentment. It's not about possessions. It's never about possessions. He says, كما تجد هذا الذي ليس عنده عمل بمقتضى الإيمان إذا ابتلي بشيء من الفقر أو فقد بعض المطالب الدنيوية تجده غاية في التعاسة والشقاء. He says, on the other hand, you find the person who doesn't have iman and doesn't do righteous deeds based on this iman, if he is tested with poverty and lack of possessions and aspirations and things that they aspire, you will find this person living in misery and despair. Because he doesn't have a greater purpose, a higher, you know, purpose to live for. So for him, if I don't have what I want, what's the point in living? That's the whole experience. And for those who attended the khutbah today, we said there are two levels that we deal with these things based upon. There's the immediate level, which is my immediate circumstances. How I deal with them, they might cause me some pain, there might be some lack. There might be some hardship that I'm going through. But that's just the surface experience. There's another experience, which is my heart, that's supposed to be connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It sees the greater scheme of things. It sees the bigger frame. Or things are just, you know, in the right direction. Even though I might lack something here, I might go through some hardship here, but I'm heading in the right direction and I'm getting reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that creates a very beautiful balance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says this to the believers and to the Muslimin after the battle of Uhud, when 70 of the companions were murdered, and they went through severe hardship after that. It was a very difficult moment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن تَكُونُوا تَأْلَمُونَ فَإِنَّهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ كَمَا تَعْلَمُونَ وَتَرْجُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَرْجُونَ. He says, if you are going through pain and hardship and agony, your enemy as well is going through some hardship, the similar hardship. So both of you are experiencing hardship, so you're equal, you're even there. But what's the difference? So in the immediate experience, you are the same. You're all going through some hardship and pain and challenge. وَتَرْجُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَرْجُونَ. But you expect from Allah what they do not expect. You expect Jannah. You're working for something bigger. So that's the different. That's the deeper level. So that creates the balance and makes us firm when we face the challenges and the wind of difficulty and hardship in this life. He gives another example. He says, وَمَثَلٌ آخَرٌ إِذَا حَدَثَتْ أَسْبَابُ الْخَوْفِ وَأَلَمَّتْ بِالْإِنسَانِ الْمُزْعِجَاتِ تَجِدُ صَحِيحَ الْإِيمَانِ ثَابِتَ الْقَلْبِ مُطْمَئِنَّ النَّفْسِ مُتَمَكِّنًا مِنْ تَدْبِيرِهِ وَيُسَيِّرُهُ لِهَذَا الْأَمْرِ وتسيره لهذا الأمر الذي داهمه بما هو في وسعه من فكر وقول وعمل وقد وطن نفسه لهذا المزعج الملم وهذه أحوال تريح الإنسان وتثبت فؤاده. He says, another example for the believer, someone who believes in Allah, believes in the life after death, in the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the punishment, and that this worldly life is not the whole story. He says, if causes of fear and trouble befall such a person, you will find a man so firm in his heart that make him firm in his ground. So he sees beyond the moment. A man is firm, so it keeps him stable. مُطْمَئِنَّ النَّفْسِ. You will find his self and his chest tranquil. So yes, there is hardship, but that's not the full story. So I'm connected to more than what I see, to more than the hardship that I'm going through, to more than just the fear that I'm experiencing now. So I can transcend that fear because I see with my heart a deeper reality, a bigger context where things are in the hands of Allah, things are under control. Even though I seem to be losing control, but that's what I can see and that's what I can sense with my five senses. But I know that's not the whole story of reality. There's much more hidden parts of reality And that's basically Allah is in control. So I hand myself over to Allah and I know Allah is in control. So that gives the person that kind of tranquility and stability and firmness and peace in the midst of all of these challenges. مُطْمَئِنَّ النَّفْسِ مُتَمَكِّنًا مِنْ تَدْبِيرِهَا. And this gives you clarity. When you have this kind of inner peace and tranquility in the middle of the storm, you can find this quiet escape that's based on your understanding that Allah is in control, that everything is just happening according to the plan of Allah. So everything is in good shape. When you enter that peaceful place in the middle of the storm, in the heart of the storm, you are able to use your mind without being, you know, frantic, without freaking out and losing your senses in the heat of the moment. So yes, it's a very difficult condition, it's a challenging circumstances, and there's a lot of reason for fear and confusion and loss of attention and focus, yet because your heart is firm and stable and tranquil, it gives you the stability and it gives you the luxury to study things, observe them carefully, and pick or choose the right course of action. The right course of action. So you have this security, inner security inside. You can always tap into it, regardless of how tumultuous or how challenging and difficult the external situation is. So it says, مُتَمَكِّنًا مِنْ تَدْبِيرِهِ وَتَسِيرِهِ لِهَذَا الْأَمْرِ الَّذِي لَهَمَهُ. So when these challenges fall upon you, because you have this peace and tranquility and the stability inside, you can assess the situation better. You don't lose your senses. You don't lose your focus. بِمَا هُوَ فِي وُسْعِهِ مِنْ فِكْرٍ وَقَوْلٍ وَعَمَلٍ. Then this person will tap into whatever they can do. I can change that situation. Let me see what I have, what I can change, what I can do, what I can fix. Then I'll just do this, and because I have contentment, I can't change the whole situation, but I'm content with what I can change now. قَدْ وَطَّنَ نَفْسَهُ لِهَذَا الْمُزْعِجِ. He's ready, he's prepared for this challenging, disturbing condition. وَهَذِهِ أَحْوَالٌ تُرِيحُ الْإِنسَانَ وَتُثَبِّتُ فُؤَادَهُ. He's saying this state of being makes the person comfortable in the midst of trouble and turmoil, and makes his heart calm and focused. كما تجد فاقد الإيمان بعكس هذه الحال إذا وقعت المخاوف انزعج لها ضميره وتوترت أعصابه وتشتتت أفكاره وداخله الخوف والرعب واجتمع عليه الخوف الخارجي والقلق الباطني الذي لا يمكن التعبير عن كنهه لا يمكن التعبير عن كنهه. He says, on the other side, you see the person who lacks iman and lacks the righteous deeds that are based on real iman and faith, when challenging circumstances are there, when there is fear, this person will be blown away by that fear, will be completely bewildered and confused by this overwhelming fear or challenging condition. And he will suffer anxiety, loss of focus and attention, and he will be taken completely by panic and fright. He'll be completely frightened. And then not only this, two levels of fear will combine and match to take him over. That's basically the fear that's coming from outside, the immediate circumstances and external conditions. And he says, القلق الباطني, the inner anxiety and fear that we have no words to explain. And this inner anxiety and fear comes from failing to know Allah and connect to Him. Because when the heart doesn't know why it was created, it doesn't embrace the purpose for which it was created, it experiences a very tacit, yet powerful and profound level of fear and anxiety and trouble inside. So you find the person troubled deep inside, even though they might be having some nice times sometimes. But there is that feeling of void, emptiness, anxiety, loss, lack of meaning, meaninglessness. They don't know what they live for. They're searching for something, but they can't find it. So he says, وَهَذَا النَّوْعُ مِنَ النَّاسِ إِنْ لَمْ يَحْصُلْ لَهُمْ بَعْضُ الْأَسْبَابِ الطَّبِيعِيَّةِ الَّتِي تَحْتَاجُ إِلَى تَمْرِينٍ كَثِيرٍ انهارت قواهم وتوترت أعصابهم وذلك لفقد الإيمان الذي يحمل على الصبر خصوصا في المحال المحرجة والأحوال المحزنة المزعجة. He says this type of people who don't have the iman, if they do not learn certain techniques and certain practices to reduce that level of anxiety, and these techniques and these procedures that can lower the level of anxiety, they need a lot of rehearsal, they need a lot of training in order to develop them and master them. These people usually in times of hardship, they experience a nervous breakdown. And that's because they lack iman, the kind of iman that equips you with a profound type of patience and sabr, specifically at challenging circumstances. So he says, فالبر والفاجر والمؤمن والكافر يشتركان في جلب الشجاعة الاكتسابية. He says, the righteous person and the evil person. The righteous person and the evil person. Both of them have access to these techniques and strategies to reduce the level of anxiety, the level of fear, the level of trouble in their life. And they also share the access, وَفِي الْغَرِيزَةِ الَّتِي تُلَطِّفُ الْمَخَاوِفَ وَتُهَوِّنُهَا. And also, they have access to the natural ability. We said, if you remember, those who attended the first session, that some people have, in their genetic makeup, they have this kind of easygoingness. They have this easy nature. They're calm by nature. That's how Allah created them. So these are instinctive characteristics. Some people, as we said, are just troubled. Some people are very nervous by their own nature. Some people are more calm. So it's saying the person, whether they are righteous or they have no faith at all, both of these people have access to the natural demeanor of who they are, if it's leaning more towards being calm and tranquil and peaceful and easygoing. And they also have access to strategies that are learned from experience and also learned from science and also learned from research on how to reduce the level of anxiety and fear in one's life. He's saying, but the believer here stands out. وَلَكِنْ يَتَمَيَّزُ الْمُؤْمِنُ بِقُوَّةِ إِيمَانِهِ وَصَبْرِهِ وَتَوَكُّلِهِ عَلَى اللَّهِ وَاعْتِمَادِهِ عَلَيْهِ وَاحْتِسَابِهِ لِثَوَابِهِ أُمُورًا تَزْدَادُ بِهَا شَجَاعَتُهُ. He says, whereas the believer has an advantage here. And the advantage that the believer has is the strength of his iman and the level of his patience and his ability to tap into this state of reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seeking reward from him for any circumstance that he goes through. He says all of this increases the level of his courage. All of this increases the level of his courage in the face of these hardships. وَتُخَفِّفُ عَنْهُ وَطْأَةَ الْخَوْفِ وَتُهَوِّنُ عَلَيْهِ الْمَصَائِبِ. He says, and all of this reduces his suffering. As we said, because he's tuning into not only the immediate experience, but he's also tuning into and he's also connected to a greater experience, which is beyond the seen world. And we said that's the function of the heart. So it reduces his level of anxiety and makes hardships easier for him. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, which is the verse we quoted previously, إِن تَكُونُوا تَأْلَمُونَ فَإِنَّهُمْ يَأْلَمُونَ كَمَا تَأْلَمُونَ وَتَرْجُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَرْجُونَ. So if you go through pain and hardship, they also go experiencing similar pain and hardship. وَتَرْجُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَرْجُونَ. But you hope and you're looking forward to something greater from Allah, which they completely lack. They don't hope for anything. There's no hope for them. So their experience is limited to what they are experiencing or what they are facing immediately, the immediate conditions or circumstances. Whereas you as believers, yes, you are going through the immediate experience, but that doesn't color your whole experience or your whole state of mind. That's only part of it, because you have another input, which is, we said, the greater frame of things, the grand scheme of life. So he says, وَيَحْصُلُ لَهُمْ مِنْ مَعُونَةِ اللَّهِ وَمَعِينِهِ الْخَاصِ وَمَدَدِهِ مَا يُبَعْثِرُ الْمُخَاوِفِ. He says, Also the believers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them and He aids them with His own help and with His own support. And this kind of support obviously diminishes and takes away, blows away the reasons and the sources of fear. وَقَالَ تَعَالَى وَاصْبِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and be patient, indeed Allah is with the patient ones. That means Allah's support and Allah's help is with the patient ones. He says, he moves now to the reason or the means number two on how to attain a tranquil and happy life. He says, وَمِنَ الْأَسْبَابِ الَّتِي تُزِيلُ الْهَمَّ وَالْغَمَّ وَالْقَلَقِ الْإِحْسَانُ إِلَى الْخَلْقِ بِالْقَوْلِ وَالْفِعْلِ وَأَنْوَاعِ الْمَعْرُوفِ وَكُلُّهَا خَيْرٌ وَإِحْسَانٌ وَبِهَا يَدْفَعُ اللَّهُ عَنِ الْبَرِّ وَالْفَاجِرِ الْهُمُومَ وَالْغُمُومَ بِحَسَبِهَا وَلَكِنْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِ مِنْهَا أَكْمَلُ الْحَظِّ وَالنَّصِيبِ He's saying one of the means that repel anxiety, worry, concern, and fear is kindness to others. Extending a favor to others. Doing some act of kindness to someone else. And he says, extending a favor or kindness to others, either by means of speech or by means of action, like an actual kind of kindness or service that you offer the person. Or any kind of help and support. And he says, and any kind of kindness and help is considered to be good and is appreciated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, by means of this kindness and favors that you extend to others, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repels a lot of the reasons that bring about fear, worry, pain, and trouble in life. And he says, this rule acts for the believers and people who lack iman. It works for every human being. He says, وَلَكِنَّ لِلْمُؤْمِنِ مِنْهَا أَكْمَلُ الْحَظِّ وَالنَّصِيبِ He says, but the believer taps into a higher quality of this. So you get it better. A believer gets it better than someone who doesn't believe. وَيَتَمَيَّزُ بِأَنَّ إِحْسَانَهُ صَادِرٌ عَنْ إِخْلَاصٍ وَاحْتِسَابٍ لِثَوَابِهِ And this point of excellence comes from the fact that the act of kindness and generosity and favor that he's extending to others is actually stemming from his sincerity to Allah. From his sincerity to Allah and seeking Allah's reward. فَيُهَوِّنُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ بَذْلَ الْمَعْرُوفِ لِمَا يَرْجُوهُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitates for him to extend this act of kindness because he knows that Allah will recompense him. So he sees a greater context. Someone who doesn't believe says, okay, if I'm going to donate $10,000, I will lose it. Fine, but they are good enough to donate it. But a believer says, I'm donating this $10,000, but I'm getting it from Allah tenfold, right? So it makes it way easier for the believer even to extend more acts of kindness because we see a bigger context. So it says, لِمَا يَرْجُوهُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ وَيَدْفَعُ عَنْهُ الْمَكَارِهَ بِإِخْلَاصِهِ وَاحْتِسَابِهِ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removes away and repels a lot of the causes of pain and hardship in a person's life just because of these. And this is exactly what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says. The Prophet ﷺ says, دَوُوا مَرْضَاكُمْ بِالصَّدَقَةِ Treat the ill ones among you with صَدَقَةِ And he says, إِنَّ الصَّدَقَةَ تُطْفِئُ غَضَبَ الرَّبِّ You give some money out in charity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps someone recover and heal. And the صَدَقَة extinguishes the anger of Allah. And there's something beautiful. Another hadith from the Prophet ﷺ. This is very profound. He said, صَنَائِعُ الْمَعْرُوفِ صَنَائِعُ الْمَعْرُوفِ تقي مصارع السوء. What a beautiful, beautiful hadith. Unbelievable. He says, صنائع المعروف. Doing acts of kindness. Extending acts of kindness. Protects you from having an evil end in your life. It protects you from dying in an unfavorable or disgraceful state. صنائع المعروف تقي مصارع السوء. So extending kindness will cause you when you die to die in a very good state. So he's saying here simply, you want to do away with worry, fear, pain, and stress and anxiety, just do someone a favor. Extend some kindness to someone and you will see how it will be removed. And this is something that you know from experience. Even sometimes, if you just, you know, give someone a genuine smile and you just make them happy, you just feel that kind of, it fills you up, that fulfillment and that satisfaction fills you up. Because Allah subhanahu wa, the Prophet says, أحب الناس إلى الله أنفعهم للناس. The ones that are dearest and most beloved to Allah among the creation are the ones that are most beneficial to others. The ones that are most beneficial to others. So if you add value to people's lives and you have iman, you're more likely to be amongst the people that Allah loves most. And subhanAllah, you see, Islam has these beautiful, profound meanings. But sometimes we limit it to certain technicalities. But that's not the whole picture. We need always to keep our eyes open on the organic nature of Islam. Okay, just using this term, organic nature. Because Islam is more of a full, holistic experience. And we need to be aware of this. أَحَبُّ النَّاسِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَنْفَعُهُمْ لِلنَّاسِ. The ones that Allah loves the most among the creation are the ones that are most beneficial to others. Beneficial through acts of kindness, through favors. What, anything, any service, any value you can add to someone's life adds to your assets or to your reserve with the amount of love you're going to get from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it also brings you a lot of happiness in this life, a lot of satisfaction, a lot of fulfillment. You know, when you help someone out, you relieve them out of a challenging situation. Everyone knows this. You experience some kind of satisfaction you can't even buy with money. You can't. You can't buy. You know, find someone who's hungry, buy them a sandwich, buy them a meal, and feel the satisfaction. And you know, let's make our this halaqah a little bit practical. In this next week, this weekend or next week, why don't you make it a point to search for someone who's really going through some hardship, financial or emotional? I would say financial is easier. Why? Because emotional, you might be sucked into a very difficult situation. So let's say financial. So you know someone like who suffers even to get their daily food. Honestly, I remember one day, I was here in the masjid, and there was one of the brothers, a new Muslim, but he also has, I only saw him once in the masjid here. And I was told that he has some issues in his mind. So he sees a psychiatrist, etc. But he's able to relate to people. Still, he's, to a certain extent, he's normal. And I remember I saw him, but he asked a couple of questions, answered his questions, then I left. And that day I was hungry, so I decided to go and buy some shawarma. So I went to the shop, and I saw they had an offer, so you get one for $6.50, but you get two for $9.50. So I said, there was another guy here in the masjid that I usually like, if he gets something, he shares it with me. So I said, okay, I'll buy him a sandwich, this other guy. So I bought two sandwiches and I came back to the masjid. I look at the brother who I intended to give, who's usually here in the masjid. So I wanted to give him the sandwich. And I see him dressed up really nicely. He's wearing a suit and everything. I said, you know, what do you have today? He says, I'm invited for a very big meal. I said, SubhanAllah, I bought you a sandwich. Like, I didn't say that, I was in my mind. That was in a conversation. I said, I bought you a sandwich. SubhanAllah. I'm not going to give you a sandwich and spoil the meal for you. Khalas, I'll let you go. So I didn't share with him anything about it. So I had my sandwich and I left the other. I didn't know what to do with it. Then subhanAllah, I remembered that brother who asked me the questions. And I said, he's a new Muslim, he has issues with his family, he has a lot of issues, and he's trying to find some work because of his condition, he can't even find work, etc. So I thought, maybe he's hungry, let me go and check. I hope he's still in the masjid, because it's been like about an hour now. I come back to the masjid, I find him sitting there, right there. I come to him and said, how are you doing, you good? I said, did you eat today? He said, you know what, I haven't eaten anything for 2 days. I haven't eaten for 2 days. I said, you haven't had anything? He said, for 2 days I haven't had anything. I said, why didn't you ask? He said, I'm embarrassed to ask. But I said to him, did you ask me the questions that you had? Did you want answers, or were you trying to open up a conversation? He said, honestly, I was speaking to you hoping that you would offer some food. SubhanAllah, you don't know sometimes. So I gave him the sandwich. And wallahi, for like 2 days, I was in a state of peace and tranquility that I have no words to describe. Just by helping someone, offer him some food. So let's do it this weekend, or next week inshallah. Find someone to help out. Maybe someone has a debt that he needs to pay off. Sometimes it says as little as $100 or $200. So you know that you can afford that. Don't put yourself in trouble. You can help that person. Go ahead and do it. So make it a point to find someone who is in need of help and offer them that help and see how you feel. So that's the advice of Shaykh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'di here. So he says, قال تعالى لا خير في كثير من نجواهم إلا من أمر بصدقة أو معروف أو إصلاح بين الناس ومن يفعل ذلك ابتغاء مرضات الله فسوف نؤتيه أجرا عظيما. He quotes this verse from Surah An-Nisa. He says, there is no benefit, there's no good in most of their conversations, their private conversations. They're just, you know, idle talk, empty speech. There's nothing. People just talk and talk, and there's no point in that. Except for someone who enjoins or advises someone else to give sadaqah or extend some kindness and generosity, or to reconcile, you know, two people or two groups of people, to bring about reconciliation among people. He says, for most of what people say, there's no benefit in it. Except in these cases, when someone, you know, advises someone or directs another person to give sadaqah, to help someone else, or to bring reconciliation. And he says, وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ ذَٰلِكَ ابْتِغَاءَ مَرْضَاتِ اللَّهِ فَسَوْفَ نُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Whoever does one of these, seeking Allah's pleasure and Allah's reward, we shall give them a great recompense. So he says, فَأَخْبَرَ تَعَالَى أَنَّ هَذِهِ الْأُمُورِ كُلَّهَا خَيْرٌ مِمَّنْ صَدَرَتْ مِنْهُ وَالْخَيْرُ يَجْلِبُ الْخَيْرُ وَيَدْفَعُ الشَّرْ وَأَنَّ الْمُؤْمِنَ الْمُحْتَسِبُ يُؤْتِيهِ أَجْرًا عَظِيمًا وَمِنْ جُمْلَةِ الْأَجْرِ الْعَظِيمِ زَوَالُ الْهَمِّ وَالْغَمُ وَالْأَكْدَارُ وَنَحْوُهَا. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in this verse that all of these things that we mentioned in the verse are actually good, regardless who they come from. Regardless who they come from. Whether a Muslim or a non-Muslim, someone who believes in Allah, someone who doesn't believe in Allah. So these things bring up, and he says, all of these things are good, and good brings only good. And it repels evil. That's the balance in the universe. When you do something good, Allah is going to repel an evil that was on its way to you. And oftentimes you have no clue about that. Sometimes you might say, I've done so many goodness, but I've never seen the fruits. Maybe there were so many things, harmful things on their way to you, and by means of that goodness that you did, Allah removed those things without you knowing about it. All of this was happening in the background, and you didn't know about it. Just trust. Just trust and let go. Let Allah be in charge. So he says, good always brings about more good and repels evil. And he says, the believer is seeking reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these things, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him. And one type of reward is to remove the anxiety, remove the stress, remove the fear from your life, just by doing good. Okay, so these are two means, great means to a happy and tranquil life, shared by Shaykh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'di. First one is belief and righteous deeds. The second one is extending acts of kindness or extending favors to others. And we said, let's make it practical. So this weekend or next week, make a point to help someone out. Extend some act. You know, sometimes it's even holding the door back, the door for the person behind you. Just holding the door for that person. It could be as simple as that. It could be sometimes just some coffee. You buy yourself coffee, you buy someone else coffee. And give it, offer it to that person. And now McDonald's are giving free coffee. So you can get coffee and give it to other people. Other people. Extend the good, all right? So, as simple as that. If I know someone who's in hardship, try to help them out. Someone who lacks a piece of information that might help them in their business, in their family, in their personal affairs, you know about this. Help them out. Give them half an hour of your time. Half an hour of your time. If you don't have time, give them probably finances. Or offer them a connection. Maybe there's someone who really, in order to advance their business or improve their career, they need a connection. And you have this connection. You know that person. So connect these two people. And that's a great act of kindness. And that repels evil, and this also repels anxiety and stress and pain. And subhanAllah, this is something that's very well known even like in self-help and psychology. And in the original book that Sheikh Abd al-Rahman Sa'di read, which is Dale Carnegie's book, Stop Worrying and Start Living, he mentions a lot of examples of people who've been through some serious trauma. He talks about people who came from World War II who lost their minds and they were having suicidal thoughts and they didn't know what to do. But someone advised them to volunteer to help out orphans and widows. So they started helping out. They completely forgot their trauma and their experience. And they recovered, although previously they were on drugs, like medicine or medication, and they were seeing psychiatrists and getting a lot of professional help, but it wasn't really working that great. So when they got involved in helping out people who were in need, they completely managed to transcend their trauma and their hardship and difficulty. SubhanAllah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. Is the reward of goodness except goodness? Is the reward of kindness other than kindness? You act kindly to people, Allah will be kind to you. And part of this kindness that Allah will give you is actually take away your worries, your concerns, and your fears and replace it with happiness and tranquility and more peace of mind. So inshallah, next week we'll start with the third means of to a happy life from the book Al-Wasail Mufida Lil Hayat Al-Sa'ida. We have a couple of minutes. Any questions? Any questions? No questions? Okay. So, okay, yeah, go ahead.
A lot of examples you give is kindness to other people, so strangers or people in the relationship. But you get the same satisfaction, you get the same benefit if you have the same attention to your family, immediate family, whether it's your...
That's a very good question. You know, when you extend an act of kindness to a complete stranger or randomly, on the surface, it's more effective. And the reason is because it breaks a pattern. The problem when we extend acts of kindness to the family, we're working from a paradigm. We got so much used to it, we became desensitized. And this, thank you for bringing this question. Oftentimes, you find a parent, a father or a mother, they do a lot of sacrifice for their kids, and they see it painful. And they see maybe the kids are not appreciating it. They don't see the point, right? They might even like sometimes be defiant or reply back to, talk back to you. You guys, like, I sent you to the best school, I'm paying $2,000 a month for you to go to the best school, and you guys are talking back to me? Like, you show me no respect? Why? Because we're already in this pattern of offering our families, our children, our spouses, our relatives, some acts of kindness. We stopped seeing the value in them. That's the problem. But if you can get a fresh outlook on this, it would be more profound than extending an act of kindness to a stranger. So anything you do for the family, remind yourself that even if it's as simple as, you know, being kind to your child or saying a beautiful word to them, you actually might be making their day. You might be making their day. So try to get out of that pattern, which causes, you know, this kind of becoming desensitized to it, and see that I'm making a difference in my child's life by sending them to a very good school. I'm making a difference in my child's life by offering him a decent life. He doesn't have to go and beg for money or go and work from an early age or go... Oh, jazakallah. McDonald's. Jazakallah. Oh, that's good, good. Two cups as well. Strange things happen, right? هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. That's another kindness that came my way. Okay. So when... when you do it to the family, extend an act of kindness or favor to the family, make sure that you don't do it out of habit. You're doing it right, but try to develop a fresh perspective on that. Maybe you see your wife not feeling well or feeling upset that day. You go and do the dishes. Now the sisters are happy. You do the dishes or you buy her a flower. Or you, if she likes books, you go and get her a book or whatever, anything to change her mood. You might think, oh, that's okay, that's fine. Like, I've done this 100 times. But if you look, you know, break from that pattern and say, I've changed her day. I've made her day. I gave her a completely different experience today. I gave her a completely different experience. You'll see yourself doing something really great. It is great, but the problem is that when we get used to something, we take it for granted, we stop appreciating it. We stop appreciating it. The things that you do on a daily basis to your friends, to your family, sometimes you stop seeing the impact of this. Why? Because it's part of a pattern, recurring pattern. So you tend to underestimate these individual acts because there's so many of them. But if you see each act of them as unique, as a building block in this wonderful building, and it fits in its right place, and it's necessary because the building won't be right without this even single block, then you realize, wow, this is actually more profound. This is why the Prophet ﷺ says, وَفِي اللُّقْمَةِ يَضَعُهَا أَحَدُكُمْ فِي زَوْجَتِهِ صَدَقَةً. You know, some food that your wife eats, You're getting reward from Allah because of that. Not only this, even the Prophet ﷺ says, a husband approaching his wife, he's getting reward for that. So everything is kindness. So and basically that goes to what we said previously about handling life with a state of presence. You know, we live life, honestly, absent-mindedly. Absent-mindedly. We do the things half asleep. We do most of what we do out of habit, half asleep. You have to be present in what you do. You know, each cup of tea that you drink is different. But for you, they're all the same. But if you can develop and get the habit of developing in a fresh perspective, each cup of tea is different. Because it's happening at a different time, different circumstances, even different cup, different tea leaves, it is different. And if you pay attention to this, you will start to feel the difference. Each cup of tea will be different, will give you a different experience. Each beautiful word you say is a different experience. Each night you sleep is a different kind of sleep. It's a different experience. Every morning you wake up, it's a new gift from Allah. It's a new gift from Allah because you were dead in your sleep. Allah brought you back to life again. Developing this kind of fresh perspective is very powerful. It's part of appreciating the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what we talked about this the last couple of times, is be present, embrace those gifts from Allah. Embrace your daily experience. You know, live fully. You know, any experience, have it or experience it fully. We go through life, as I said, absent-minded most of the time. We're half awake. Or actually, we're half asleep. We're almost fully asleep. We're hypnotized. We go through life completely heedless, unaware of what's going on. Why? Because we're so used to things. But everything in this life is new. Everything is unique. Everything is fresh. Even if it's a friend that you've known for 80 years of your life, every encounter is new. There is something new and fresh about it. And if you are open, if your mind is open to that, you will start to see it. But if your mind is on autopilot, everything will be the same. All people will be the same. All cups of tea will be the same. All your encounters with your wife will be the same. All your encounters with your children will be the same. Each ride in the car will be the same. All days will be the same. This is a dull and boring life, and you won't realize the blessings that Allah puts your way day in and day out. So Jazakallah khair, the question opened a room for a lecture even. But it's necessary. So I would say, if you extend acts of kindness to a family, people who have more rights upon you, and you do it from a fresh perspective, I think it will be more rewarding. But if temporarily you can't get there, when you do it, act of kindness to a random person, it seems to give more impact. Yeah. Barakallahu feekum. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.